Right. Hello, good morning, everybody. Hi. So today I'll be talking a little bit about a little small project I started a few years ago. It's called Engineers.SG. So I'll be sharing a little bit about the magic that happens behind the scenes. What you see on the screen here are a bunch of volunteers that helped out at Force Asia earlier this year in March. I see a number of faces here who were there with us, Kathy, somewhere over there. Yeah. Right, a bit about me. My name is Michael Cheng. That's my Twitter handle. You can follow me there. There's also a GitHub organization with that name, with some of my open source projects. So a bit about my origin story. I studied arts and social sciences in NUS. I did not major in computer sciences, but I picked up programming on my own, and PHP is basically my weapon of choice. I joined a little startup back in 2011. It's called Found. And when that kind of ran out of money, as all startups do, I joined another company called Make33, and of course you all know that company to be Make Me right now. After that, I joined another company called Neo Innovation, which does agile stuff. Of course, that went away and they got bought by Pivotal Labs. There seems to be a trend going on there. Anyway, that's where I am right now. I'm at Singapore Power. I'm a software engineer there, working on some new digital products for the company. We're hiring, by the way. Anyway, moving along. Engineers.SG, it was a small little project that I started. It's a not-for-profit community initiative. So we wanted to basically help document the Singapore tech scene. What basically happened was some years ago, I attended a little meetup and somebody was complaining about, I can't find any engineers. There are no engineers in Singapore. That got me a little bit riled up. But I thought it got me thinking that perhaps we have a marketing problem. We're not telling people that we exist. We didn't tell more people that we have grassroots organizations, grassroots meetup groups that are happening. Because I think in the late 90s and early 2000s, IT is perceived to be more enterprise IT rather than open source IT stuff. So I guess maybe that's the way. So I felt, wait, there's got to be a way to tell more people about us. So videos is kind of like a way of showing other people that what we do. And of course, to also let people know that these user groups exist. So you find on our website, you go down to the bottom, you'll find a link to the event page. If you like the meetup or you like the videos that's being shown there, you can click that and go to the event page and maybe follow or join the group that's there. So that's kind of like one of the motives I wanted to. That's one of the reasons why I started this group. We started this back in October 2013. The first time we ever did this was at the user group that I run. It's called the Singapore PHP User Group. It's on October 30th that we did our first recording. It was a single camera setup. Very different from what we have right now, which is two cameras and many other things going on, so which I should go through in more detail later. Yeah, so basically, yeah, this is why I created Engineers.SG. Where are the engineers? So I want to make Engineers.SG the place where you can go to find out where the engineers are, what we're talking about, and what are the cool things that we all like to geek out about. Right. And we have been recording quite a lot of meetups in the last three years. This is just a short, small handful of the meetup groups that we meet that we record. Some stats right now. We have on our website, we've got about 1,217 videos, plus today 8 videos will be going up after today. So we'll probably hit 2020-ish. We've got 2,400 subscribers on our YouTube channel. Our monthly views is about 20,000 on our website, 25,000 views on our YouTube channel. We've recorded 21 conferences so far in the last two years plus. CSS Conf and GS Conf is the next conference we're recording. We have trained about 40 volunteers. So Engineers.SG is basically a volunteer-driven kind of organization. We don't get any money from this. And basically, it's from passionate people who are interested in contributing back to the community and people who are interested in learning about the technology that we use. So I've been training quite a few number of people. Of course, the actual active people, you probably see them at meetups, you know. So they're probably just a handful of really active ones. But we're looking for more. We're looking for more volunteers, yes. So this is our website. It's written in Ruby on Rails, if you're really keen on that. And this is our YouTube channel. So a bit about the magic. So I just recorded the iOS conference last week. And so it was on Thursday and Friday. I went back home, and over the weekend, I got the videos out. And by Monday, the guys was Sunday night and Monday. The guys were able to watch the videos. So these are the tweets, the very kind tweets from our, from the presenters for the conference. You know, like Ben Asher, who works at Yelp. He was at Singapore for iOS Conf, and basically, yeah. He said the same thing that I did last year. Like the moment he landed in SF, the videos are ready. So it's kind of cool. So how do we do it? How do we get this done? Well, I think with any kind of thing that we do, we try to streamline the capture process. I spent about a year and a half just iterating and trying out different techniques of capturing. So when I first started out, it was just one camera, and then we added a screen capture tool and a few other things. But basically, what we want to do is we want to capture all the inputs. By streamlining the capture process, is basically about capturing all the inputs together, the video, the screen capture, as well as the audio, coming into at the same time, capturing all this at the same time, and feeding all these sources into a laptop via USB. So all the right in front here right now is a laptop that is capturing what I'm. There's camera pointing at me. It's capturing my screen as well as capturing my audio, my voice. And basically goes through a software video mixer that basically records streams and it allows me to edit the video feed in real time. With this, there's basically no video post-production required. So basically, at the end of the day, the videos are ready, the MP4 files are ready, and I can upload it. So just a visual representation. So there's we have the presenter's laptop. There's a video output, like in my case, it's HDMI out. Goes to video splitter, splits the video channel, one to the projector, and the other one goes to a screen capture tool, which then gets pushed into, I plug that into the laptop using USB. For the presenter, we have in most of our cases, we have a webcam for easy ease of use. Basically, we have a lot of volunteers who are not exactly very technical, and we want to make it as easy to use as possible so that anyone can try to use our system. So we have a webcam, and we also have a small little microphone that kind of picks up the audio. So the set that we have today, currently we have about five of these sets running around somewhere. the set we're using today is set number two. I gave them names by the sequence in which I created it. Anyway, comes the webcam and the audio basically as a USB interface somewhere that captures that, and basically magically I'll have MP4 file that's ready to be uploaded. Right. Once the file is ready, the only post-processing I do is basically an audio processing. Basically, I kind of levels out the audio so that it's, so if it's too soft, I'll kind of even it out so they can hear the voice. I find this, being able to hear the voice of the speaker very clearly is a very important thing, especially if you're watching a video. You may not be watching a video, you just be listening to the video. So the audio quality is a very important thing to get right. Hearing the audio you don't have to tweak. I mean, as in hearing it in a way that you don't have to tweak your volume control is very important. For me, I use Apple earphones when I'm checking the audio levels, so that at least I know that it's with a simple, basic earpiece, I can hear the audio properly. So I do some audio processing on this right now. The script I use is actually a shell script that uses FFmpeg and another open source project called SOX, which will convert, which will basically take the video file, split it into two files, a video channel as well as audio channel, and process the audio using SOX, and then recombines them into one file. This script wasn't written by me, it was written by Cyani, who runs WeBuild. So basically I took that script and I modified it to support multi-files access. I'll show you the GitHub repo a bit later where the scripts are available. So once the audio is processed, I'll upload to YouTube, and that gets there's a cron job that runs every 10 minutes that pull the videos into our website. Once the video appears on our website, there is an admin interface where I log in to update the title, the description, and many other things. Link to slides and also link back to the events. I find it's important to link back to the event page because I want the viewers of the website to also find out more about the meetup group that's organizing this so that they can also attend future meetups and join the meetups there. Of course, that's what happens on the day itself. But what happens before that? So a bit more about the magic. Well, it's not really magic, it's just process. So I actually contact the meetup organizers because for me, getting the presenters comfortable in recording our video is important. We don't want them to feel offended, or we don't want them to show anything that if they are not comfortable with going online or being made available on the internet. So we make sure that our presenters are comfortable with us recording them. If they are not comfortable, we just say, okay, so we just won't record them. There were situations where we recorded that before, and we had to go back and do some editing after the fact. So there were situations that happened, but as long as they are comfortable with us recording it, it's fine. Then we get our volunteers to sign up on the meetup schedule. So we use WeBuild.sg for their events calendar. So we use that quite extensively to help us organize and plan our duty roster so everyone will know what's going on. And we ask our volunteers, they should sign up for the meetup as well so that the meetup organizers knows that they are going there. And then they pick up the set on the day before, and then they basically I would advise for them to reach the meetup venue like half an hour before. Typically our set is quite simple to set up. It takes about 15 minutes to set it up if you have enough practice. Otherwise, half an hour should be a comfortable time to get things all set up. So as I showed you earlier, basically after the meetup's over, I copy out the file, do some post-processing on it. And it's in a wiki page over here. You can probably find it. Yep, there you go. So there's a couple of scripts that I use. You see? There's a couple of scripts that I use. There's a multinorm.sh, which basically does audio normalization. So it evens out the audio so it's not too loud or too soft. I have a script that actually helps me to generate a thumbnail. So I think it uses FFmpeg underneath it. For videos, in the past, I used to open up the files in iMovie or Final Cut Pro to kind of cut out the parts, which is a very heavy process. So I use FFmpeg, which I wrote a shell script for, to split the file into separate files. There's another script that I use which concatenates. So basically, if I have separate videos, I can merge them into one file if I need to. I did not put that file here, but I probably should. And wait, it might be here. Nope, it's not here. Never mind. I'll figure that out. So so this is all open source, so you can actually see what's going on. Multinorm.sh. If you dig inside there, it's nothing more than just reading through some files, copying it to a folder, splitting the files, normalizing it, and recombining it into one file. So yes, it's shell script. And let's get back to this. After this, we update the admin page, and then we also post a link back to the meetup page. So we try to use our short URLs. We try to link them back to our website because there are situations in the past where we had to take down videos. Like there were some videos that would, and YouTube is kind of bad in a way, they don't let us re-upload the same file or change the video at the URL. They don't let us do that. So we have to find a way. We felt that we need a permalink. So the permalink should be our website rather than the YouTube page. Most recent situation was at iOSConf. iOSConf, I had one video that I uploaded, and apparently the speaker actually changed the title of her talk. And so I had to re-edit the video, but I kept the link the same on the website. So that made it a lot easier to manage. Of course, there's a simpler process. Just upload the file somewhere that Michael can retrieve it, and then I'll process the file, which a lot of my volunteers do. OK. So this is some of the open source resources. So we have a GitHub page that we maintain all this, where I documented my process of setting up this project. So there were a couple of, in this wiki guide, I include some prerequisites, what you should try to create a YouTube channel, YouTube account, how you can add other people to your channel so you can have other people help you manage your videos. I've also documented different ways that you could possibly try to do this yourself. So original goal when I first started Engineers.SG was to try to get all the meetup groups to get involved, to tell the meetup organizers to, hey, get your own volunteers to record this video. But it turns out not many meetup organizers have a big pool of co-organizers and volunteers they can tap on. The other option I had was to think about getting venue owners to be involved. The venue owners, like Microsoft, will have one set here, and then we can just draw it out. But that creates a administrative burden on the venue owners. Basically, whoever works at Microsoft has to be around for us to draw it out and return it. So that didn't work out. So using a bunch of volunteers as a core team of volunteers to go around to different meetups was, I felt, a better option for this. So, but in doing so, I also want the volunteers to learn how to do this themselves if they so choose to. So like in here I documented different processes of doing it, either using your own camera. So if you have your phone, you can download the YouTube there's a YouTube capture app which you can use to like record videos and upload it straight to your YouTube channel. So you can use your phone, and then you could even like at the bottom, put it on a smaller tripod and you can record your meetup. The audio capture on the iPhone is actually quite good. The video capture as well is also quite, for the more recent cameras like iPhone, all the pluses, basically the bigger ones have image stabilization, which is kind of great for this. Like in the past, what I'll do is when my main recording system fails on me, I'll use that as a backup. It has happened a few times. Yeah, like for the last one, I actually used an iPad to record it. So yeah, it was okay. Using one camera is also possible. I did some research on what are the best of class cameras with good audio pickup, and something that's cheap. So I found this Zoom Q4. I think it's another one, Q4N right now, the latest model. It costs about $400+. The audio capture on this is actually very good. Zoom makes very good microphones, and this is a microphone that just so happened to have a HD camera. Of course, much later I found out that actually Sony cameras are actually not bad. Like the one that you see at the back right there, that's our backup camera. The backup camera costs about $200-ish. You can get it from Lazada. And the audio capture on that is quite good. There were situations in the past when my primary system fails on me, and I had to rely on the audio capture from that piece of thing. So it's not too bad. How am I doing on time? Okay?
Yeah.
All right. So that's for video capture. There's also the audio, the recording of the screen. So how do I do recording of the screen? If the presenter is using a MacBook Pro or MacBook, they can actually just start the QuickTime app and just start a screen recording of their own screen. And this can even set it up to use the built-in microphone so that you can, basically I can record my screen right now as I'm doing the presentation. So that's one way. Of course, you want something that's less intrusive. What I strive for in our setup is to not require our presenters to install any software. Like solutions in the past would be, oh, please install this driver here, or please install this USB thingy and all that stuff, which can be quite intrusive, and I think it's not good to have to push this on presenters. So what I wanted to do is to have a non-intrusive way of capturing what is happening on your screen. So what I'm using is a hardware screen grabber that's called EverMedia Live Gamer Portable. This is actually type of devices are actually created for gamers. For gamers to capture their gameplay. So like PS2 or Xbox, they use that to capture their HDMI output or something. So I'm using this right now. Actually in front here to capture my screen. In the past, I had an analog system, so I had to do some manipulation. But basically, getting the HDMI feed in, There's a software that basically lets me record the video, and I could do post production editing with iMovie or something like that. And of course, eventually I came to a point where, look, I don't want to have to take all these separate files and combine them in post-production. How do I do this? There's a couple of software that's out there. This is one of those that I used in the early days. It's called XSplit Broadcaster. It costs about $4.95 as a monthly subscription. So that's what I used to use. Of course, nowadays, there is a new software out there that I'm using. It's called OBS Project. Thanks to Rahul, who actually recommended this software to me many years ago. So he's like, look, guys, you should use this. It's free. It's open source. When I first started, it was quite crappy. It wasn't as good as it was. It only had a Windows version, and the Mac version wasn't as powerful, because I was using a Windows machine, and I actually did try to use my Mac to do recording in the past. The result was mixed. I can get good video on it, but it's not as good. Especially for the device I'm using, the Mac drivers are not as compatible with OBS, which is kind of strange. It has its own proprietary drivers, which is kind of weird. Anyway, so this is a free software you could use. That's the last link here. I also put up a small little video tutorial. If you are really, you are so inclined, you want to watch a video of me telling others how to set this up, you can watch this. Yeah, there's nothing you can try. My website is also open source, so you can actually check out the website on GitHub. It's a Ruby on Rails app, so you can scroll down. There's a whole bunch of instructions how to get the code, how to set up Ruby, how to install Postgres, and how to get this thing started and even deployed onto get this thing deployed in somewhere. We did take part in Tech Ladies earlier this year. So Tech Ladies is a smaller program that help women learn about programming by working on a project for a NGO. So they basically work on the Engineers.SG website as their program. Anyway, so basically, I open sourced it so people could actually check it out and even contribute back. There have been quite a number of pull requests that I received in the past. So thanks to all those who actually sent pull requests. So a few photos of our team in action. So this is when I was at MeetMe, that was where I first started recording the videos. We had a weekly thing called Hackers and Painters. So if you guys come to my office and I record the thing. So this is me recording. I can't remember his name, but he's presenting on Kibana, which is a visualization tool for stats. Apparently, this is our most popular video most viewed video on our channel. It's about 170,000 views so far. Quite scary. This is the first conference that we recorded. This is at GeekCamp 2014. So the first conference that we attended to record multi tracks and stuff. It was quite scary because I had to buy another set of my recording gear just for this. So it was kind of scary, but it got it done. So this is our typical recording setup, where we record on the bottom we have my laptop with an audio mixer as well as a video camera here. So the video camera was always pointing at the speaker, like right now in front of me. There's a Sony camera pointing at me, so that records me, my face. And this is AVMedia Live Gamer Portable, which is a screen capture tool. There are a bunch of these screen capture tools out there. Elgato has one. Blackmagic has a couple of these screen capture tools as well. So you can actually look those up. What I like about AVMedia is that it has very good support for different types of screen resolutions. So you can support 4x3, 16x9, which some of the other screen capture tools don't support. And so it works through USB 2, so I don't need to have a very powerful machine to run this properly. Yeah. So it's my setup at Force Asia. I had a little small little stool where I put my laptop there. You know, it's almost every single meetup I go to has, I have a different configuration. And it's kind of fun. This is a software in action. This is open broadcaster software. So I could in real time move this around and adjust and move the resize and adjust the different screens. I could set up different default arrangements of screens, which I could then pre-configure and then switch into the correct scenes as and when it is required. So that's how you can, if you watch the videos on Engineers.SG, the screen transitions look so smooth because it's all software. Software for the win. For audio recording, as I said, I put a premium on good audio recording. So having good microphones to pick up the sound and of the speaker, the voice of the speaker is important. So in my case, right now I'm using a lapel mic, which is hooked up to my shirt sleeve. In other situations where I don't want the volunteers to intrude on the speakers, I'll just put one condenser microphone right in front of them. Like you see in front there, that's one of the condenser microphones that we use. I'm using that for question and answers, so your voice can also be heard by whoever's watching the video later. Yeah. But in most situations, we only have one, which will pick up the speaker's voice. You will still pick up a little bit of the background sound, as in the Q&A, which we can kind of even out using our audio processing tool, which will kind of evens out the sound. So it levels out the background sound to Q&A. Will probably be at the same level, audio level, as the speaker. Yeah. So this is an example of the wireless clip mics that we use. We first used this at PyCon in 2014, I think. In PyCon because one of the organizers who was there kind of told me, hey guys, the audio that they had last year was quite bad. We need better audio. Said, okay, fine, sure. Let's get this. It's not cheap though. So it's an audio. This is a sound mixer that we use. I don't use this anymore because I found a smaller and more compact device over there. It's the Zoom H5. Yeah, it's a good recorder. In most of our systems, I also have a backup system. I also have a backup microphone and a backup audio recorder and backup camera. Why do I have a backup? Because it's running Windows. Well, thankfully, it has not crashed too badly on me before, so it's okay. But in situations where the recording does go sour and or something doesn't have, that we don't capture the audio properly or it's out of sync or whatever, I could use a backup video to reconstruct the slides and a backup audio to pick up to reconstruct the video that I need. Because for me, the audio and the slides are the most important thing. My gesticulation and all that stuff, that doesn't matter. It's my voice and the slides. It's more important. So having backup systems is important for me. And I think, like right now, in this case, I have a backup camera at the back that's pointed at the screen. So it's recording the screen. So if anything happens to my system, I can reconstruct the slide transitions using that. I have another camera in front. This is also recording a video. So in case that crashes, I still have that to recover. And the H5 itself is actually recording my audio as it sends it to the live stream. So, and of course, the software OBS, now the benefit of using OBS is it has support for live streaming. So you can stream to Twitch. OBS is actually, again, another gamer's tool. The gamers use that to do Twitch, to screencast their Twitch, to their Twitch channels of their gameplay and all that stuff. So OBS is actually a pretty good tool. It's for streaming as well as recording. So with all this gear, we need to have a way of carrying everything around. So I resorted to getting my mom's old suitcases and stuff. At first, it was kind of ghetto. We just use a shopping cart, right? How hard can it get? I mean, there's not much stuff. How bad could it be? It's like less than $20 for this little thing. So it turns out it wasn't a good idea. Why? Because you're carrying a lot of gear and the wheels are flimsy. I bought two and both their wheels broke. I don't know why. I don't know how the guys were handling it, but the wheels broke. I think because the gear was too heavy, they're carrying up staircases and all that stuff. It broke. And I was like, man, I'm not going to spend more money on this shit. Let's get some proper suitcases. And that's when Mustafa comes in. Mustafa has some really cheap and good quality suitcases. So yeah, all these two on over here are used for carrying. So here are the three of the sets that we have. Again, I have a total of 5 sets right now. 2 of them are actually stored in a secret location where my volunteers can pick up and use during meetups, for meetups. When they're done, they can bring it back there and store it in the secret location. Okay. So I named them by the order in which I accumulated the equipment for. The equipment that I accumulated, it actually started early this year. So in March, when I was recording recording Force Asia, they needed to record 5 tracks simultaneously. So which is why I had to start buying additional equipment just to help make that happen. So right now I have 5 sets. Yeah. So if you are interested in helping out as a volunteer, there are enough sets for you to carry around. In the past, when I first started doing this, it was the meetups were not as regular. There were only like 1 or 2 meetups a week, at most 2 a week. But nowadays, it's like 4 or 5 days a week I'm involved in going for meetups, and on my team, rather, we're all going for meetups and recording meetups, which is kind of cool. Cool for the community, but stressful for us. Thankfully, I have a job that lets me knock off at 6 o'clock, so it's thank you, Singapore Power, and Pivotal, and Neo. we do have a cable management problem because, you know, carrying so much gear around does require a lot of cables. So yeah, we do have. But then again, my rationale is, you know, we'll only be there for a couple of hours. I don't think it's that much of a deal. But for conferences, when I do record conferences, I try to tape down stuff like over there. There's a little black tape, gaffer tape, or duct tape. Yeah, simple. So what's in our bag? Here's what our set number 3 and 4, which is what our community members use. This is laid out on the table what the guys would carry to the different meetups. I'll just go through some of them. We have a Windows laptop because OBS Studio works best on Windows, especially with the screen recording tool that we have. And it has been proven to be quite effective. And it's cheap. I got this off Carousel for like $200 to $300. With a dedicated graphics card somewhere. It's quite good. Anyway, so it's for screen capture. I also have a bunch of video adapters. So I want to prepare for every situation, every kind of output that the presenters bring to us. So over here we have HDMI. Okay, there's another slide here. So we have a VGA to HDMI. We have which is meant for locations where there's only VGA projectors. We have mini display port to HDMI. We have a display port to HDMI and HDMI to VGA and a few other things. So yeah, we're ready for you. Except USB-C. Which I'll probably have to get soon. Actually, I have a couple of them already. I have a couple of them, yes. Right, so for the recording audio, to simplify things, I basically got a blue Icicle USB. It's a USB sound card which has a XLR interface, a 3-pin interface, which can be connected directly to a condenser microphone. So with this setup, because condenser microphones requires you to send an electrical charge to it to basically charge the diaphragm. So basically, it requires a electrical charge which the Icicle can provide. So it basically will power the condenser microphones. Why do they use condenser microphones? I think they have the best audio pickup overall. Webcam. So we have a Logitech webcam that we use. The cable is kind of long, about 2 meters. But we, in case we have situations where the presenters is quite far from you, we have a 10-meter USB 2 extension cable just in case. Here's a screen capture too. It uses a mini USB cable that connects to the laptop. HDMI cables as well as a HDMI splitter. So in the past, when we first started out, it was all VGA because there was only 2 that I know how to use. Then much later, I figured out that we could actually use HDMI as the capture. This video camera, this is usually the backup camera that you see at the back. the backup audio recorder. I'm using the Zoom H1. It's kind of cheap, about $100+ for this. So it captures really good audio. Bunch of tripods and for the backup camera as well as the main camera. And of course, you need power. So yeah. So what's next? What's up? What are the next steps that we want to push Engineers.SG to? I want to try maybe, these are my wish list. I don't think I have the capacity to actually do this right now, but these are things on my wish list, and I hope that I can get some volunteers to help out and spearhead some of these things. One of which is to produce transcripts for videos so that people can easily skim and scan the text of the content of the talk, and even make it searchable by keywords. And even translation and subtitling so that it makes our video accessible to the region. So I envision in future we could have a Bahasa version or Vietnamese version which can be made available and people in those countries can watch and learn some of these things. And also find a way to build to optimize our workflow further, to automate the upload and distribution process. Because right now it's still rather manual after the fact. I still need to upload the files and all that stuff, update the content and stuff. So these are our volunteers that we have. You know, as you see, this on the left, we have the volunteers for Force Asia. On the right is our volunteers at PyCon 2014, I think. Should be 2014. Yeah, so we have Beyond here, Valentine, Natalia, and a few others. Yep. I feel bad for some of the volunteers at Force Asia because they were there to attend the conference and I was shorthanded. So I kind of like, hello, can you help me? And they were all very kind in helping me, and I'm really, really, really thankful for all of them. So you will find that what we're doing is inspiring and kind of mildly interesting.
Or useful.
Do join us and support us. You can email me at admin@engineers.sg. You can also follow us on Twitter, Engineers for the Win. Or you can like our page on Facebook. Or if you're so inclined, you can actually support us by clicking on this little link over here, which will bring you to a little support page where you can help out in some small monetary means, you know. So no pressure. Don't do it if you don't want to. Yes, that's all I have. Questions? Yes, Roland.
You mentioned your overwhelmingly most popular talk.
Uh-huh.
In terms of views. Have you learned anything interesting about which speakers or topics or events get most views after the fact?
Well, keywords, if it's a buzzword filled kind of talk like Docker or or Kibana or something like that. So search terms and key and buzzwords do draw a lot of views. Big name speakers also draw a fair bit of views because I think partially because they retweet or reshare it on their own Twitter account or through their social network. So therein also brings a lot of views. To be honest, I think I need some data science on this. We need data science shit out of this to find out what are the popular ones. I have not done it yet, so it's something I probably should try to figure out. Not that I want to use that to target different, find out which other meetups I should record or whatever. I try not to curate that. Because I really want to capture all the content, as much of the content as possible. I try not to curate or target things. But I do recently on the website, I actually added a featured section so I can actually target or highlight noteworthy videos. I think recently I highlighted the keynote videos from iOS Conf during the Agile conference. After the Agile conference, I also highlighted some of the, I also brought up the as a featured video, some of the keynote speakers from Agile conference. So there are some ways of servicing things, and usually if it's the first video on the home screen, on the home page, usually it gets quite a fair bit of views as well, because it's usually the first item you click on to kind of get a sense of what are the videos there. Yeah, I should really data science this and do some.
It seems like an interesting
It would be an interesting project. Yes, it would be an interesting project. Any other questions? Yes.
I hear you mentioned you started this to increase the visibility on engineers in Singapore. But I also like to say big thanks from all engineers that it's also useful to engineers themselves because we don't have time to attend all of these talks and sometimes we miss out. It's great to be able to follow along anyway. Yeah, so thanks a lot for that.
Thanks.
I have one question though. So you sure you have a lot of gear that you bring, that your volunteers bring down for every event. Have you ever lost any equipment? And do you have any tips and tricks on how to make sure that your volunteers actually bring back all the equipment?
I have lost things before. Even myself personally, I've lost. It's usually our forgetfulness when you're in a hurry, packing stuff away, like power adapters and stuff. So I do have a. I did lost one power adapter once. I think it was stuck to one of the. I haven't actually solved that. So I think some of my volunteers did suggest having a packing list so they can look through it and then they can do double check what's there. In the volunteers training, when I conduct volunteers training, I would ask the volunteers to learn how to unpack the pack and repack the set. And I would tell them which are the pockets they should put the specific items so that they would know what needs to go back where. That is helpful in helping them remember what they should be keeping. For some of the equipment, for most of the more expensive equipment, I actually put the Engineers.SG sticker on it so people will know that it belongs to us. There was one situation where we had a laptop bag. So we were at Force Asia, there were a lot of Lenovo laptops flying around. And there was one particular bag. There were a lot of those laptop bags, right? We weren't sure whose belonged to. And it just so happened that I stuck the engineer's actually stuck sticker on the laptop bag, so he was able to find it. About the videos being useful for engineers, yes, that's one of the goals. I wanted this to for people to also learn from these videos. One of the validations I have of this was at my workplace at NIO, NIO Innovation, like last year. I was doing something, and then my colleague was during lunchtime. He was watching a video behind me. I turned around. What was he watching? It was a PyCon video of one of my other colleagues talking about PyTest. Yeah, testing in Python, and then apparently we were working on a Django project, and he needed to learn skill up on testing in Python. He was watching a video that my team recorded. So for me, that was a big validation that people are actually using it for the purpose that it was meant to, which I think is a good thing. Okay. Yes. It's not for profit, yes, but we do need money. So for certain things, like some conferences, I actually do charge a small fee. The money actually goes to helping upkeep the equipment that we have. It's also the same there's a company behind this project, and the company is also used to organize PHP conference, which is PHP Conf Asia, which I run, and basically the money that I earn from the conference also gets funneled back into purchasing equipment for all our sets. What I learned from this is, I think a community can be really. I think we have a great community here, that everyone is willing to share new things. And I, as word got out that we're doing this, there were more meetup groups that were interested in getting their events recorded, which I find is very cool. It's a cool thing, and I hope I have more volunteers. I really wish I had more volunteers that can do, that can capture everything. But I've come to the conclusion that completeness is not a goal anymore. I don't need to capture all the videos, which could be a good thing, which means you guys have to start going for meetups. Yeah, so. Does that answer your question?
Yeah.
Okay. I don't actually benefit much from this. I have sleepless nights.
If anything, it's the community that benefits.
Yeah. I hope you guys enjoy it. Yes, Vishnu?
When you're recording in two different cameras, has clock drift ever been an issue? Like, I've heard that things can be like 1 second off when you're doing like an hour long video.
Clock drift, you mean OBS?
Between the cameras or OBS?
Well, I think I'm recording 50 FPS on both cameras right now, so I think it should be fairly okay. But the problem does arise when I put these two together with the screen recording, because the screen recording is recorded at 30 frames per second, and the videos are going at 50 frames per second. So sometimes it does happen, but I'm using Final Cut Pro, that kind of reduces that probability. So the workflow during conferences, for post-production during conferences is, I'll take all the video sources, pull it through into Final Cut Pro and synchronize them using the audio. So I use the audio to synchronize a bunch of clips together so that I know that when it's, the video clips will be in sync. So when I need to cut out or edit out parts, I know that the audio and the movement of the lips are kind of in sync. We didn't have a problem before in the past when we were using webcams where the lips are moving but the audio is like 10 milliseconds off or something. So there's a bit of a disjoint there. But those can be fixed. Those can be fixed in post production. But in the previous system, when I was figuring out the audio setup on OBS, I did have to put on the video camera a few millisecond offset, so that you'll be in sync with the audio. But once I figure out how to actually solve that problem by not putting it as a source, but putting it as a audio input rather than an item in the scenes list, it kind of fixed the problem. Yeah. Yes. Took a while to figure it out, but yeah. Yes. I know.
Have you tried anything that looks promising?
To be honest, I've not had the bandwidth to actually explore that yet. But there are ways. I mean, there's auto subtitling on YouTube, which is kind of crappy. I've not actually looked into that. Although, if you go to any of the videos on YouTube, we are kind of enrolled into a program called the Amara Project. So the Amara Project does. Just scroll down over here.
All right.
So if you scroll down here, there's an Amara link where you can contribute back to. Ooh, did I click the wrong one? Oops. Where are you? Yeah, okay. So there's an Amara project page where you can actually contribute to subtitles of different videos. And I've also recently turned on the community contributed subtitlings. So there is a option here that allows communities members to contribute subtitles of different languages. So you could do that as well right now. Yeah, I have not had the bandwidth to actually explore this further. Yeah, so if anyone of you would like to help out, I'll be very happy to grant you access to stuff. Yep, thanks.
I think that's about as much time as we have for questions.
All right. Thank you very much.
Michael, not just for the talk, but also for the talk. Well, next up we have Roland, who is going to talk to you about